Welcome to the International Conference on Holistic Christian Theological Education. Before we start, I would like to ask everyone who is in the two rows at the back to come up. Let's fill in all the front rows first. Everyone with the two rows back, please come up so they will fill in the front rows. Leave the room back for those who will be trickling in later. Also, if you have a communication device, whether it be iPhone, Samsung, iPad, iPod, whatever, would you put it in the vibration mode so that we will not be disturbing one another through all those SMS messages? I'd like to first welcome all of you to International Conference. And if you look at your white booklet, you must have received two booklets today. White booklet and a green booklet. If you look in your white booklet and turn to page 7, Roman numeral 7. Turn to Roman numeral 5. We'll have conference schedule. Conference schedule at Roman numeral 5. We will be going according to this schedule with minor changes tomorrow. I will inform you of changes tomorrow. Has to do mainly with what time we'll have coffee break for lunch, things of that nature, especially tomorrow. As we have our conference, we will be overlapping with BID students here who will be having their regular chapel and lunch period. And so we will make some minor adjustments to accommodate for that change. I will inform you of that again tomorrow. Now, I would like to welcome Reverend Dr. Surasa Kittirongsang, Dean at the Bangkok Institute of Theology, Christian University of Thailand, to give welcoming speech.
On behalf of the Bangkok Institute of Theological Seminary, I would like to welcome you wholeheartedly to this year's International Conference on Holistic Theological Education. This is the second time that we are hosting the International Conference. An international conference like this is a very timely and important for theological institutes, as we have entered Asian Economic Community, or AEC. Such a conference is imperative for several reasons. First, from this year on, it is important that we are more aware and able to adapt to the English language and the English world, as English will be used more regularly. We have to face the challenge of embracing the English language into our daily life. To this end, this conference is in English along with some time to facilitate understanding. The second, as communication and travel becomes easier and more accessible, theological institutes must face the challenges of theological education, which should be made more accessible. Theological institutes must cooperate with one another in order that launch a more holistic curriculum. To this end, many of theological institutes are embarked to memorandum of understanding or MOU. Now that we have neighboring institutes that are easily accessible, we must make the most of this God-given opportunity to raise the next generation of theologians. Third, as theological education has its roots in the West, it is normal, it is natural that many of the courses and curricula have been affected by Western mindset and culture. However, the issue and challenge that the East faced are vastly different from the West. Thus, it is important that Indian institutes divide the curriculum that we met the needs of the East. To be sure, there are many thoughts and methods of the Western world that are necessary and relevant for us today. Many of these truths, as much as they are biblical basis, will not change. As such, they must be embraced. But there are others that are shaped by culture which might be not necessarily fit in the Eastern thought and method of theology. This area must be adjusted to be the relevant and to produce the best results in theological education. To this end, this year, International Conference will challenge us to think about ways and ideas to make the most of our system of education. I heartily welcome all of you to use the next 2 days to reflect and discuss about various issues, thereby making all of us better holistic theologians of the future. Thank you.
Before we start our theological education conference with the plenary keynote speakers from abroad, let us first pause to worship our Lord, our God, through time of devotion. Our devotion today will be led by Mr. Wirachai. ก่อนที่เราจะเริ่มคอนเฟอเรนซ์นานาชาติเราจะเริ่มโดยการนมัสการครับเพราะการนมัสการของเราจะรับการนำโดยนายวิรัชชัยครับขอบคุณครับ
Good morning everyone สวัสดีครับ Seven people beside you สวัสดีครับ So before we start we will have a short worship service the song name Give ThanksSo I want everybody to stand up for a while นะครับผมอยากให้ทุกคนยืนขึ้นสักครู่หนึ่งแล้วเราจะนมัสการพระเจ้าด้วยบทเพลงที่ชื่อว่า Give Thanks นะครับ sit down, everyone. กรุณาเชิญนั่งลงได้นะครับ Our speaker for this event is Reverend Dr. Hong Sik Chin.
Let's pray.Heavenly God, you are almighty. You are the only God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. You are one God. Thank you for your grace and given to all of us. And I thank you.To let us have this wonderful conference internationally. The Lord just bless us, particularly this pouring hour of your word, so that we might lift our soul to you and live according to your will. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior.Today, my theme is holistic aspect of the world. Scripture verses has come from the 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, saying, Be diligent to present yourself approved to God.A workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handle the word of truth. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God. This phrase points a man of God. Man of God isThis strategy of God to do his work. Moses, David, Paul, Luther, and Carrie, all of them, the strategies of God to achieve his plan of redemption. All theological institutesMust produce man of God, man who does not be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. This workman is the one who knows truth of God.Which is comprised of three dimensions, comprised of written God word, living word, and spoken word. Tony, the one who is talking aboutรอบด้านของพระวจนะของพระเจ้าพระคัมภีร์ตรัสอยู่ว่าจงอุตสาห์ถวายตัวท่านเองที่พระเจ้าทรงรับรองแล้วแด่พระองค์เป็นคนงานที่ไม่อับอายสอนพระวจนะอย่างถูกต้องนี่พูดถึงคนงานคนของพระเจ้าโมเสสดาวิดแล้วก็พอลลูเทอร์และคนอื่นๆทั้งหมดเป็นยุทธวิธีของพระเจ้าในการทรงกระทำการงานของฉะนั้นคนงานเหล่านี้เป็น คนที่ไม่ต้องอ่านสอนโลจนะอย่างถูกต้องเพราะฉะนั้นคนเงินนั้นต้องเข้าใจลักษณะรอบด้านของโลจนะของพระเจ้าซึ่งประกอบด้วยโลจนะที่บรรจุไว้โลจนะที่ดำรงอยู่ในชีวิตสุดท้ายเป็นพระวจนะที่เป็นคำพูดสามด้านนี้เป็นทำให้พระวจนะของเจ้าของพระเจ้ามีครบถ้วนในการเข้าใจ First dimension is the written word namely the BiblePaul admonished Timothy saying, accurately handling the word of truth. Bible is inspired as the word of God by the Holy Spirit, as some 40 different authors wrote their part of the word over a period of 1600 years.God illuminates also when it is read, so that the readers may understand it just as what its writer want it to be, to mean. Believing both roles of the Holy Spirit in inspiration and illumination,One who is called to a minister of the word of truth should know how to rightly handle the word of word. Here comes the important role of interpretation on the part of the ministers. Then a servant of the word should strive to get the right meaning of the text.Which requires process of study to grasp an accurate meaning of key vocabularies. Contextual problems with various ritual analysis along with the historical and cultural background. Once the message is set up upon the basis of right meaning of the word,It is ready to be preached to the people for their salvation and sanctification. Written word is the mean of the Holy Spirit to regenerate the people, to cleanse them, and nurture them to maturity. Thus it is a powerful instrumentfor the spiritual world. George Peters, one of the famous theologians in mission, says the symbolism used to describe the word is rich and instructive. It is like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. It is the sword of the spirit.That pierce and divide asunder, separate, evaluate, judge. It is a fire that shifts and sanctifies. It is good seed that the soul planting the field from which he expects great harvest.ประเด็นที่หนึ่งของพระวจนะแห่งความจริงนั้นเป็นพระวจนะที่บันทึกไว้คือพระคัมภีร์นั่นเองอาจารย์เปาโลทรงเสริมทิโมธีว่าก็สอนพระวจนะ
อย่างถูกต้องพระคัมภีร์นั้นได้รับการทรงดลใจจากพระวิญญาณบริสุทธิ์เป็นพระวจนะของพระเจ้าโดยมากกว่า40ท่านในระยะเวลามากกว่า 1,600 ปีแล้วก็พระวิญญาณบริสุทธิ์ยังทรงสว่างให้ผู้อ่านพระคัมภีร์นี้จะได้เข้าใจความหมายอย่างแท้จริงตามที่ผู้เขียนเดิมใส่ไว้เพราะฉะนั้นเมื่อเราเชื่องานของพระวิญญาณบริสุทธิ์ในการทรงดลใจในการทรงสว่างผู้ที่ถูกเรียกเป็นผู้รับใช้พระวจนะของพระเจ้านั้นต้องรู้ต้องรู้ว่าเราจะสอนพระวจนะอย่างถูกต้องอย่างไรเขาก็ต้องเข้าใจแต่ละคำในความหมายของแต่ละคำอย่างถูกต้องพร้อมด้วยกับบริบทข้างหน้าข้างหลังแล้วก็โดยวิเคราะห์ด้านวรรณคำพร้อมด้วยกับเบื้องหลังของประวัติศาสตร์และวัฒนธรรมเช่นกันเมื่อเป็นความเข้าใจอย่างถูกต้องในบริบทและข้อพระคัมภีร์แล้วเมสเซจของเรานั้นพร้อมที่จะออกไปเป็นคำๆเพื่อแก่ความรอดและการชำระรับการชำระได้พระวจนะที่บันทึกไว้เป็นวิธีการของพระวิญญาณบริสุทธิ์ในการบังเกิดและก็ในการชำระในการบำรุงจิตใจให้เป็นผู้ใหญ่ในพระคริสต์ได้เพราะฉะนั้นพระวจนะของพระเจ้านั้นมีอำนาจฤทธิ์เดชในการรับใช้พระเจ้าในด้านจิตวิญญาณจอร์จพีเตอร์สซึ่งเป็นนักศาสนศาสตร์ระดับโลกท่านก็ถูกไว้ว่าสัญลักษณ์ที่ใช้ให้กับพระเจ้าของพระเจ้านั้นมีมากมายแล้วก็เป็นบทเรียนสำหรับทุกท่านคือว่านี่เป็นค้อนที่ทำลายหินเป็นชิ้นๆได้นี่เป็นพระแสงของพระวิญญาณบริสุทธิ์ที่ทะลุจิตใจของเราในการประเมินผลและก็ในการวิจารณ์การเป็นเข้าใจเป็นส่วนสูงสุดอย่างถูกต้องได้และวันนี้เป็นไฟเป็นไฟนะครับที่ทำให้เรารับการชำระให้บริสุทธิ์มากขึ้นและก็พระคัมภีร์ยังบอกว่านี่เป็นมรดกที่ดีที่ทดลองในดินแล้วก็จะมีงอกขึ้นจากที่นั้นเราจะเก็บเกี่ยวอย่างมากได้ก็ second dimension of dimension of the word of truth is the living word of God living with the integrity in personal lifeThis living word, in its original meaning, referred to an earthly life of Jesus Christ as the Logos incarnate. However, in the post-apostolic ages, it was understood closely as lives of believers in the process of their sanctification. I believe that the phrase, a man who does not need to be ashamed, means integrity of one's personal life. Apostle Peter saying his epistle, second epistle, now for this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and your knowledge, self-control, and your self-control, perseverance, and your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and your brotherly kindness, love. For if these qualities are yours, are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Second, integrity in the minister of the word is good for himself and also use a very influential media in the conveying of the gospel. It is like a bridge of God between God and man. Bible said in Matthew chapter 5 verse 16, let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good work and glorify your Father who is in heaven. The word that lives in the heart of the believers is good not only for unity of believers within, but also good for evangelism without, to witness to the world, the living word, how it affects and in the believer's life. But in this song, Kong, Rojana Pekan Sinan, and Rojana Ti Dam Long, Chivit Yu Nai Chivit, Kong Ku Chua. Lakshana Ni Naka, Kong Rojana Pekan Sinan, Ti Le, Ka Pung Tung, Chivit Kong Pra Yesu Krit, ซึ่งเป็นพระวัตถะกลายเป็นเนื้อหนังแต่หลังจากยุคอภิวัตกระทู้แล้วนี่เป็นหมายถึงอย่างใกล้ชิดที่สุดว่าเป็นชีวิตของคนเชื่อในการชำระให้บริสุทธิ์มากขึ้นในประจำวันฉะนั้นข้าพเจ้าเชื่อว่าคนงานที่ไม่อับอายนั้นหมายถึง integrity หมายถึงว่าเป็นบุคลิกที่ดีในชีวิตประจำวันอาจารย์พีเตอร์ก็พูดถึงเรื่องนี้ในจดหมายของท่านที่สองว่าด้วยเหตุนี้เองพวกท่านจงพยายามอย่างจริงที่สุดที่จะเอาคุณธรรมเพิ่มความเชื่อของท่านพวกท่านเอาความรู้เพิ่มคุณธรรมเอาการควบคุมตัวเองเพิ่มความรู้เอาความทนอดทนเพิ่ม คุณพ่อพวกอาการควบคุมตัวเองและเอาความยั่งเกรงพระเจ้าเพิ่มความอดทนความรักท่านพี่น้องเพิ่มความรักเกรงกลัวพระเจ้าและเอาความรักเพิ่มความรักท่านพี่น้องความรบด้านยังสมบูรณ์และบุคลิกสำหรับผู้รับใช้นั้นพระวจนะของพระเจ้านั้นเป็นดีสำหรับตัวเขาแต่ว่านี่ยังสร้างมีเดียที่มีอิทธิพลในการแนะนำพระตุจิคุณของพระเจ้านี่เป็นเหมือนสัมพันธ์ระหว่างพระเจ้ากับมนุษย์พระคัมภีร์บอกอย่างชัดเจนว่าทำนองเดียวกันพวกท่านจงทรงสว่างคนทั้งปวงเพื่อว่าเมื่อเขาทั้งหลายได้เห็นความดีของท่านของพวกท่านแล้วเขาจะได้สรรเสริญพระเจ้าผู้สถิตอยู่สูงพระวจนะของพระเจ้าที่ดำรงอยู่ในชีวิตของผู้เชื่อนั้นดีไม่เพียงแต่สำหรับนั้นลงใจเดียวกันในคริสตจักรแต่อันนี้ดีสำหรับการประกาศเพื่อถึงแก่คนโลกเช่นเดียวกันเพื่อให้เรารู้ว่าพระวจนะของพระเจ้านั้นอิทธิพลมากขนาดไหนในชีวิตแต่ละคนของผู้เชื่อ Third dimension is a spoken word effectuated by talent in communication. In the phrase, by a workman who does not need to be ashamed, knows how to communicate it effectively. This is another aspect of the word of truth, the spoken word. Principal elements of the effective communication is audience, Bible, and communication. Knowing audience and the Bible serve as a primary base to build relevant message in verbally communicating the word of truth. For instance, at the wedding service, a passage that might be used during funeral service, like in as much as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this come judgment, is merely not relevant, particularly for the newly wedded couple. Of all the three aspects, might be called in ABC of communication. Thus, another aspect in the holistic word of the truth is a spoken word, which has to be relevant to certain people and certain occasions. Therefore, it is ด้านที่สามของพระวจนะของพระเจ้านั้นเป็นพระวจนะที่มีลักษณะออกไปเป็นคำพูดนี่เป็นอาศัยสิ่งที่อาศัยตะลันในการสื่อสารก็คำว่าคนงานที่ไม่ตรงอัตภัยคนงานไม่ถึงอะไรครับไม่ถึงว่าผู้ที่มีตะลันในการเทศนาในการประกาศพระวจนะของความจริงและต้องรู้ว่าจะสื่อสารอย่างถูกต้องอย่างไรนี่เป็นประเด็นหนึ่งของพระวจนะของความจริงคือพระวจนะที่ผู้เป็นคำ ป็นแก่นสารอันสำคัญในการสื่อสารอย่างเกิดผลนั้นเป็นผู้ที่ฟังออเดียนซ์แล้วก็เป็นพระคัมภีร์แล้วก็การสื่อสารโดยที่รู้ว่าผู้ที่ฟังเป็นอย่างไรและพระคัมภีร์มีความหมายอย่างไรจะปรนิบัติเป็นในการสร้างพื้นฐานอันแข็งเพื่อจะสร้างเมสเซจที่มีเกี่ยวข้องเกี่ยวข้องกับคนที่ฟังและสถานที่ที่จะพูดดังนั้นก็สามด้านที่กล่าวมานี้นะครับก็คือว่า A B C ในการสื่อสาร A audienceB band number C communication นะครับ Therefore it is my conviction that in order to handle the word truth in a holistic way it must be considered three aspects of the word that is not only aspect of understanding its meaning as the written word but alsoHere are the two important aspects of a living word through one's personal life and of spoken word in talent or communicational tool. To sum up, the written word reflects the past. Living word reflects integrity of the person. The spoken word reflects the talentin communication. This BIT would be holistic educational objectives for the Theological Institute, hopefully for the Institute BIT. Personal, Nippon, Van, Net, Jai, Gong, Kavata, Va, Purati, Tasa, Kavata, Nayang, Tung,ในลักษณะรอบด้านของพระวจนะในการเข้าใจความหมายอย่างถูกต้องเป็นพระวจนะที่บรรจุไว้แต่ยังมีอีกสองด้านซึ่งเป็นด้านที่สำคัญเช่นกันเป็น living word พระวจนะที่ดำรงชีวิตและพระวจนะที่พูดออกมาเป็นคำๆได้ในการเทศนาถ้าว่าจะเป็นสรุปแล้วพระวจนะเป็นความจริงนั้นพูดถึงพระคัมภีร์ซึ่งพระวจนะที่บรรจุไว้เป็นอย่างหนึ่งพระวจนะที่ดำรงชีวิตในชีวิตของเชื่อนั้นเป็นอินเทอร์วิชั่นก็ของผู้เชื่อหรือคนของพระเจ้าและก็อีกอย่างหนึ่งพระวจนะที่พูดเป็นคำนั้นเป็นอาศัยตาลันในการสื่อสารซึ่งเป็นตัวย่อของสามด้านนี้ BIT เป็นอุดมการณ์ในการเข้าใจพระวจนะอย่างรอบด้านหวังว่านี่เป็น objective นี่เป็นเป้าหมายของสถาบัน BIT ด้วยขอบคุณมากครับ
kind of spontaneous to do two languages spontaneously our co-convener for this yearWe are at BIT, we're not just doing this, organizing by ourselves, but we are cooperating with McGilvery College of Divinity, a division of theology of Phayak University of Thailand. And so we thank our co-convener. The co-conveners today, this year, happen to be the two presenters of their paper as well. The first person, Mr. Brian Lima, is here. And the second person, Mr. Wittaya Putaraksa, is on the way here from Dongmyeong as I speak now. So he'll be here in about 20 to 30 minutes. In addition to the co-conveners and the person who has come from Christian University to join us and to honor us with her presence, this year we are honored to have two keynote speakers. The two keynote speakers are from Myanmar and from the United States. Our first keynote speaker, keynote speaker Tan Rang, มาจากประเทศเมียนมาครับประเทศเมียนมาท่านเป็น keynote speaker, first keynote speaker is from Myanmar and I would like to introduce him to all of us. He is the president of Myanmar Reform Presbyterian School of Theology. He is the president of that school, and as he comes and gives his speech, I pray that we will all receive the benefit on the subject holistic theological education. For those of us who would like to hear this in the Thai language, you may have the ear plug, but for our first speaker, he has asked that I translate side by side along with him. And so we'll do just for this first speaker, and then I think from next one, we'll have the translation at the back. So may I, without further ado, may I ask Dr. Chon Ho Jin from Myanmar to come to the front and give his presentation.
Good morning. Oh, how are you? Yeah. It's my honor to be invited by PIT, and I thank you to Dr. Sarang and Dr. Shi. And I want to speak English, Hongolish actually. Thank you for your translation. May I sit down? Yes. Now, first, I'd like to introduce, I'm a little shocked. Everyone, Western style gentleman dress. But Cambodia, Myanmar, no gentleman dress, Western style gentleman dress. This is normal, but I want to identify with Thai culture. So I intentionally bought the Thai dress with Thailand. It is the land of gold, that's my idea, that's true. Yeah, gold color Thai dress, but everybody here only Western style shoes. Yes.
ท่านท่านไทยใช้ภาษาเขมรแล้วนะครับกัมพูชาขอโทษใช้ภาษากัมพูชาแล้วและขอบคุณท่านรองศาสตราจารย์นงลักษณ์ท่านคณบดีดร.สุรศักดิ์ในการเชิญครั้งนี้มาแบ่งปันครับก็เพื่อเข้ากับคนไทยได้ดีขึ้นก็อุตส่าห์ไปซื้อเมื่อวานหรือ2วันก่อนอุตส่าห์ไปซื้อเพื่อให้เข้ากับประเทศไทยมากขึ้นและเห็นแล้วเราก็ใส่สูตรของโลกตะวันตกทั้งนั้นเลยนะครับ
Yeah, just let me tell you, I worked in Cambodia for 6 years as a president of a Cambodia Presbyterian Seminary. So I almost forgot to wearing the Western dress.
ครับได้ใช้เวลา6ปีในการทำงานที่พระคริสต์ธรรมที่ประเทศกัมพูชาก็เลยลืมใส่ชุดสูทนะครับ
Yeah, then last year, June, I came from Cambodia, moved from Cambodia to Myanmar to serve Myanmar Reform Presbyterian School of Theology. So I want to quickly introduce by the project, yes.
เมื่อทำงานที่รับใช้ที่ประเทศกัมพูชามาพักหนึ่ง ก็ได้มีโอกาสโดยการทรงนำของพระเจ้ามารับใช้ที่ประเทศเมียนมาในฐานะเป็นอธิการบดีของพระคริสตจักรที่ประเทศเมียนมาก็เลยขออนุญาตจะฉายพันธกิจที่ประเทศเมียนมาสักพักหนึ่งสักช่วงหนึ่งครับ
Yeah, this BIT very wonderful school with a good facility, good faculty members, good administration, library, but our school almost the beginning, like a baby.
BIT ประกอบไปด้วยคณาจารย์กับสถานที่ต่างๆและห้องสมุดและนักศึกษาทุกอย่างก็รู้สึกพัฒนาไปดีมากแต่พระคริสตธรรมที่ประเทศเมียนมาที่ข้าพเจ้ารับใช้อยู่ก็ยังคลานอยู่ยังไม่ร่อยพัฒนามากเท่าไหร
่เดี๋ยวจะรันเนาะคอนเนคชั่นจะรันจะไม่มีตัวเครื่องมันมาที่บ้านเสียกับเสียงเดี๋ยวJust I was asked to present paper on holistic theological education from Dr. Shin.
ครับมันเป็นไรครับเราจะเข้าไปในเนื้อหาเลยนะครับเนื้อหาเกี่ยวกับการศึกษาศาสนศาสตร์ครบวงจร
But just I knew that his understanding of holistictheological education is a little different from the here my understanding of the holistic theological education.
ความเข้าใจเรื่องหัวข้อการศึกษาศาสนศาสตร์ครบได้อาจจะต่างนิดหน่อยนะครับข้าพเจ้าจะพูดจากมุมมองหนึ่งนะแต่ว่าทาง BIT และทางมอคริสเตียนอาจจะได้ตั้งในความหมายอีกแง่หนึ่ง
โอเคครับพวกผมจะมีประเทศทําเอาทําไม
ครับก่อนที่เราจะเริ่มแล้วนะครับทีนี้ IT ก็ดีแล้วนะครับเราจะดูภาพต่างๆเกี่ยวกับพระคริสตธรรม MRP TCST
Yeah, our school began by the most Korean Presbyterian missionary. So all this project is for Koreans.
มหาวิทยาลัยพระคริสตจักรของเราก่อตั้งโดยและกำลังดำเนินการโดย missionary เกาหลีเพราะฉะนั้น PowerPoint ทั้งหมดก็ใช้ภาษาเกาหลี
Yeah, this school began in 2007. Right now we have only about 36 students with six full-time professors.
พระคริสตจักรนี้เริ่มในปี 2007 เรามีขณะนี้เรามีนักศึกษา 36 คน และมีคณาจารย์เต็มเวลา คณาจารย์เต็มเวลา 6 คน
Here, about Myanmar, but moving change. Yeah, we began in 2007 and we have only two course, BTH, theological bachelor course, and last year, December, we began the early child education department, Luang Biruwaka.
ครับเรามี2หลักสูตรที่พระคริสตธรรมนี้นะครับหนึ่งก็คือหลักสูตรของ BTH, คือปริญญาตรีด้านศาสนศาสตร์อีกอย่างหนึ่งก็คือการศึกษาสำหรับเด็กวัยปฐมวัย
And we want to start the MDB program in English.
และเราปรารถนาที่จะเริ่มหลักสูตร MDB โดยใช้ภาษาอังกฤษ
So from every Friday, Saturday, about 25 students are learning English special class.
และปัจจุบันมีประมาณ25คนที่กำลังศึกษาภาษาอังกฤษทุกวันศุกร์วันเสาร์
Then first I'd like to introduce why we began the early child education department.
อยากจะขอแนะนำว่าด้วยเหตุใดเราได้เริ่มการแผนกการศึกษาเด็กปฐมวัย
Yeah, our 25 alumni is planted the church.
ประมาณ25ศิษย์เก่า25คนจากพระคริสตจักรนี้ก็ได้ไปก่อตั้งคริสตจักร
But the last year, unfortunately, four churches were closed by the local area leaders.
แต่ปีที่ผ่านมาสิ่งที่เศร้าอย่างหนึ่งเกิดขึ้นก็คือว่าผู้นำท้องถิ่นสั่งให้ปิดคริสตจักร4แห่ง
In Myanmar right now the freedom of religion are very very limited
ที่ประเทศเมียนมาเดี๋ยวนี้เรามีความจำกัดในเสรีภาพของศาสนา
so one church with the kindergarten no problem so we started early child education department to train the kindergarten teachers
แต่เมื่อเห็นคริสตจักรต่างๆถูกสั่งปิดเราสังเกตว่าคริสตจักรที่มีการบริหารและดำเนินการเรื่องศึกษาการศึกษาปฐมวัยเด็กเหมือน nursery หรือป.1 ถึงป.6 ประมาณนี้ก็ไม่ได้มีปัญหาเพราะฉะนั้นเรากำลังสร้างผู้นำในพระคริสตธรรมให้มีความรู้ในเรื่องนี้เผื่อเขาจะไปทำอย่างนี้ด้วย
โอเคก็เช่นเป็นThe right now we have the four full-time Korean missionary, two native professor.
ในปัจจุบันเรามีคณาจารย์คนเกาหลี missionary เกาหลี4ครอบครัวและคนท้องถิ่น2ครอบครัว
But we don't have yet library. Everything still poor.
แต่ยังไม่มีห้องสมุดเป็นทางการหลายสิ่งหลายอย่างก็ยังมีคุณภาพไม่ถึง
Changing. Yes, this is the 2007 the picture of the beginning. Yeah.
นี่เป็นภาพของ2007ตอนที่พระคริสตธรรมเริ่ม
Okay, this is our campus.
นี่คือ campus ของเรา
Yeah, we have the big playground. So in our school areas, six.Baptist Seminary. So sometimes almost every Saturday they come to our school to play football.
เรามีสนามกว้างมากเคยไปดูแล้วกว้างมากและรอบๆพระคริสตธรรมนี้ก็มีพระคริสตธรรมของชนเผ่าชินและคนเหล่านี้ก็จะมาเล่นสนามเล่นในสนามของเรา
And here village town non-Christian young men come to playin our school we are open to everybody
และคนในที่ในชุมชนบริเวณนั้นก็มาเล่นในสนามนี้ด้วย
Yes but our school is a beginning
แต่พระคริสตธรรมของเราต้องบอกว่าอยู่ในขั้นเริ่มต้น
Okay, thank you. The close. Then I like to introduce. What does it mean by reformed? Yeah, can you? Yeah.
อยากจะขอเริ่มโดยคำนิยามว่าคำว่าปฏิรูปศาสนาคืออะไร
Yeah, in Cambodia or Myanmar, every local, every church seems they don't like or Presbyterian or reformed.
ในประเทศกัมพูชามีหลายแห่งเหลือเกินที่รู้สึกไม่สบายใจกับคำว่า Presbyterian หรือคำว่าปฏิรูปศาสนา
Yeah, but reformed means in a simple word back to the Bible
แต่คำว่าปฏิรูปศาสนาถ้าให้คำนิยามแบบพื้นฐานแล้วหมายความว่าการกลับไปสู่พระคัมภีร
์ Yeah, our school to want to train foster the ministers serving the local church
เป้าหมายของพระคริสตธรรมของเราคือเพื่อจะผลิตผู้รับใช้เพื่อไปปฏิบัติและรับใช้ในคริสตจักรท้องถิ่น
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, then go back to the our main topic.
ขอให้เปิดในหน้าที่หนึ่ง
Yeah, foster. Page 7, your paper.Yeah, first we need to define what is a holistic mission.
ก่อนอื่นนะครับเราต้องเริ่มโดยคำนิยามโดยต้องเข้าใจกันถูกต้องด้วยการว่าคำว่า mission แบบครบวงจรคืออะไร
Yeah, do you in 1974 do you know Lausanne Congress?
ในปีที่1974 Congressที่มีชื่อว่าโลซาน
This Nojang Congress began almost began to use the term terminology holistic vision, holistic vision.
ในการประชุมโลจังคอนเกรสปีนั้นเขาเริ่มใช้คำว่า holistic mission mission แบบครบวงจร
Yeah, then this assumption had the that former evangelical mission tend to too much emphasize on the saving the souls
เขาพูดว่า mission เดิมเน้นในการใช้เน้นในการกู้วิญญาณอย่างเดียวมากเกินไป
and their assumption is the evangelical early evangelical missions do not emphasize social action or social concern
และพูดต่อว่ากลุ่มของ evangelical กลุ่มที่เน้นข่าวประเสริฐไม่ค่อยให้ความสนใจกับงานสังคมหรือกิจกรรมในสังคม
So the holistic mission represents the keeping the balance between evangelism and social action.
เพราะฉะนั้นในปีนั้นเขาใช้คำว่า mission ครบวงจรเพื่อจะให้ความหมายว่าเป็นการให้ความสนใจทั้งในการกู้ดวงวิญญาณและออกไปทำงานที่สังคมด้วย
But sorry, but I don't like to agree with this assumption because in Korea, in Myanmar, in Cambodia, early missionary did evangelism and service together.
แต่คำพูดอย่างนี้ที่บอกว่า evangelical ไม่ให้ความสนใจกับงานกู้งานประกาศและงานในสังคมข้าพเจ้าไม่ค่อยเห็นด้วยกับคำวิจารณ์แบบนี้เพราะว่าในถ้ายกตัวอย่างที่เกาหลีกับกลุ่มที่เป็นอีแวนเจลิกอลกลุ่มที่เน้นข่าวประเสริฐเขาก็ได้ทำทั้งการกู้วิญญาณและก็กู้สังคมด้วย
Yeah, and yesterday evening in our discussion with Dr. Shin, his idea of holistic theological education is to keep also balance in theological education, covering everything from the biblical subject, theological subject.liberal arts and using everything, not only one side direction. Right?
แต่ว่าในการประชุมครั้งนี้ conference ครั้งนี้แรกจะเปลี่ยนทิศทางนิดหนึ่งและบอกว่าการศึกษาศาสนศาสตร์แบบครบวงจรนี้ไม่ได้หมายถึงในศาสนศาสตร์ในพระคริสต์ธรรมและในสังคมแต่ว่าในโลกของศาสนศาสตร์อย่างเดียวเราจะให้การสอนอย่างไรเราจะมีหลักสูตรอย่างไรที่มีการเน้นเรื่องของ
Well, thank you very much, Ajahn Sam, and thank you, Ajahn Sunasat, the VIP faculty, for the kind invitation to come up and to present on the topic of holistic theological education. Appreciate being able to follow Dr. Jun. Oh, that's not me. I don't get to.Carry the title of Dr. Jun. Thank you, Dr. Jun, for your fine address this morning. And, to just share honestly, when I first received the invitation to come and share with you this afternoon, I said, well, sure, I'll come and help. And then I thought more about the topic and I said, holistic theological education. What do I know about holistic theological education? And I said, wow, that's going to be a challenge for me to do some research to find out about holistic theological education. I'm attracted to the word holistic because, as Dr. Jun mentioned, I am concerned about how we integrate the gospel, not only in terms of evangelism, but also social action.And so that was a beginning place with my orientation to the word holistic. But today, maybe you might be wondering, holistic theological education, what am I going to hear about? What is it that I'm really here to learn about? And I want to assure you that the problem is not a language problem. It's not about English. Holistic theological education is not a term that is well understood, or it's not a well-defined term. And so as I tried to do some quick looking in the internet and to try to see what kind of resources were out there already about the topic of holistic theological education, I said, you know, there's not a whole lot written about holistic theological education. And so this might be a great opportunity for us to claim the term for ourselves and to define it in a way that is practical. Define it in a way that we can make best use of the term for helping us in terms of our ministry, whether it's in BIT or throughout the seminaries in Southeast Asia or throughout the world. And so that's my hope as I looked at the topic of holistic theological education. And so the way I want to approach this today is I want to start off by looking at the meaning. Now, I'm not planning on following the manuscript because you have that in front of you. You can use that and read it at your leisure. But I want to just quickly highlight the things that I thought were most beneficial for me as I did the research into the topic. So I want to begin with looking at the meaning of holistic theological education, and to do this, I want to start by looking at it word by word, and starting backwards, starting with the word education, and then looking at theology, and then the whole term of being holistic. And so when I looked at the definition of the word education, now, instead of looking at a regular standard dictionary, I enjoy looking at Wikipedia, because what Wikipedia does is it gives you input from a whole range of people who are using these terms and trying to define the terms, because I really believe that language is dynamic. And so definitions of words are continuing to evolve. There's not just one static definition, but you want to see what the basic etymology is of the word, the basic meaning coming from its roots, but then to see how usage is defining the term. And so it's very important to look at that. So for the word education, even though it begins with people thinking that, okay, education is really a transfer of information. And so the model is, again, something coming from one person's head, transferring to the other person's head. That's one way of looking at education, that it's a transfer of knowledge from one person to the next. Well, that basic definition has also been expanded by some who said, no, I think education needs to be formative. So as I looked at the Wikipedia, they talked about any experience that has a formative effect on the way one thinks. So something that is formative is something that's helping to transform one's thinking, transforming perhaps one's life, transforming perhaps one's actual actions and teaching as well in the future. And then looking at our Thai Ministry of Education's concern for our students here in Thailand to develop in the area of critical thinking ability, we see that education needs to be able to help students to really evaluate the inputs, to be able to wrestle with what they're learning, so that it's not just simply taking it in and then regurgitating it out, trying to memorize facts, but actually working with these facts and then assessing whether something has value, something is true, asking the hard questions of the information that they're taking in. So instead of just simply a transfer of information, the emphasis is being placed on the learner's ability to think critically and to think about and with the information. What do I think about this information is the way that you think critically, and then what will I do with the information? So the recognition that education is not only to acquire information, but even more importantly, to learn how to think and act. Okay? So we're wanting to emphasize internalization and integration of knowledge so that it has a positive formative effect on the life of a learner. Okay, so that's education. And then when we look at the word theology, theology comes from the two Greek words, theos, God, and logion, or words of God. And when we set it aside, the disciplines, the other disciplines like biology, where we see that biology's definition would be the study of life forms, we would say that theology is improperly or formatively described as the study of God. However, even as we look at something like theology, which we feel like we own as being our term that we can define, we see also a range of meaning that develops. And so some would emphasize that it is a religious training. Looking at the word sasana, when we think about religion, that's oftentimes where, as Dr. Jun mentions to us, that's where oftentimes we run into the blockages in trying to talk with other people, that it's not just simply about God, but then people begin to think about religion in terms of culture and traditions and belonging to organizations. The definition was expanded by some to include training for a professional vocation. And when I saw that part of what some think that theology is about, I said, no, that's not the part of theology that we really are so concerned about. When we're talking about theological education, I don't think we want to put the emphasis on a professional vocation as much as we want to put the emphasis properly on knowing God. That knowing God is a personal relationship with God, and it includes knowing about God. But knowing God involves an experience with God as well as information about God. And so theology that I'm interested, the kind of theological education that I'm interested in being able to pursue and to help our seminaries to pursue, is the kind of theological education that will bring people into a relationship with God and helping people to personally experience who God is. Because it's only as people personally have this experience with God that they truly gain the kind of wisdom that they are able to then impart to others. And that's what really makes for a person prepared for any kind of vocational ministry. And so the kind of theology that we talk about is not only designed for people who are going into full-time ministry, but I hope that the kind of theological education that we're going to be talking about can be more practical for even down in a small group and one-on-one kind of sharing. You know, that we're talking about very, very practical, not institutional, theological education as well. The final term, holistic. You notice that I spelled it with a WH. And I actually chose that spelling because as I looked at the definition of holistic, this really, I think, belongs to primarily the nursing profession, that the word holism comes from the medical field where there's more of a concern for alternative healing systems. And that's where the beginning comes for this word holistic and holism. And holistic, spelled with an H, usually is dealing with the total entity. And thinking here is again that the whole person, that when we approach the healing, or the discipline of medicine, that the when we look at the whole person, that whole person is more than the combination of the addition of all of the sum parts. And so when we approach the discipline of homeopathy, then we're talking about how we need to look at the person's body, spirit, and also the social systems all combined in how we treat the person. So when we look at the word holistic, the word holistic is simply an adjective, almost like the word, I was trying to think of other words that have that IC adjective ending, and one of the words that I came up with is toxic. Now that's kind of going in the opposite direction, but it really talks about, again, when you attach an adjective to any noun word, like you can have a toxic a potion, a toxic medicine, that something would be poisoning even the medicine. So you can have something that's good, but as we look at the word holistic, holistic as an adjective simply means the whole, or the entire, or the complete. So it could be a holistic method, a holistic process. It could be a holistic approach. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to look at the whole of the system rather than just looking at isolated parts. Okay? And so that's where this word holistic comes from. And when we use this word holistic combined with theological education, because I've already said that holistic is simply an adjective, we can think of this word holistic as defining the word theological, or we can think of this word holistic as defining the word education, or the combination of the whole term, theological education. And so what I propose to do as we look at this term, holistic theological education, is I want to look at the word holistic, looking at it completely in terms of holistic theology as well as holistic approaches to education. Okay? So that's why I've chosen to divide this topic into looking at the content, the theological content, and then looking at the looking at the means or the methodology for being able to do theological education. So the definition then that I propose that we work with is the enterprise of learning to know God as well as about God and His will in ways that fully and formatively engage learners in the enterprise. And so the emphasis that I want to place in this definition is again that we are seeking to know God as well as about God in His will. Okay? And we're seeking to do this in ways that fully and formatively engage learners. So we want to be looking at approaches that will help us to consider the learners, how a learner will be able to most beneficially be able to take in the information and not only to take it in, but also to be able to apply it. So it's a matter of being able to internalize and then to integrate the kind of information that's involved in the theological education. Okay, so first of all, let's turn our attention then to the matter of the content of theological education. As I say here, when we're talking about God as our topic, really, for theological education, how can we ever say that we know, we can say everything about God? If we're talking about being holistic, and we're talking about a God whose ways are higher than our ways, and His thoughts are higher than our thoughts, we obviously will not be able to say everything about God. But again, it's because of God's initiative, as Dr. Shin has mentioned this morning. It's God who has chosen to reveal Himself to us. And so from God's self-revelation, then we can begin to look at the matter of what has God revealed and then to try to, as best as we can, take that self-revelation and look with a balanced way. And I think that's a key word in looking at this, this term of being holistic, is that we're trying to look at what God has revealed and trying to look at it from all different facets, from a whole picture. I use the example, I don't know if you've got that picture on our PowerPoint of the eye of the elephant, but if our attempt was to try and John Suchit, do you have the PowerPoint control there? You got a picture of that elephant's eye? Coming out? That's okay. All right. No problem. I had a picture of an elephant's eye, but if you can imagine, many of you have seen an elephant's eye. If you were looking at the elephant's eye in isolation, okay, just looking at the elephant's eye, and you were trying to build a house for that animal, can you imagine the size of the house that you would build for an animal that had an eye about that big? It would be hardly enough to house an elephant. And I use that as an analogy.
Sometimes how we overly focus on this one part of the elephant. Do I need to do something?
Are we back? Oh yes, that's much better. Thank you. So again, if we're looking at the eye of the elephant, or we're just looking at one part of God's self-revelation, and just focusing on that one part instead of looking at the whole picture, that we're more prone to making mistakes. We're more prone to having results that will be far from satisfactory. We're going to have discrepancy in our final analysis of what we have here in front of us. And so if we're really seeking to know God, we need to be looking at as much of God's self-revelation, and we need to be seeing it in a balanced way, is really the point. And so when we look at some of the contemporary theological issues that we see, I think one of the theological concerns that is very current is the liberation theology is one current concern where much emphasis is placed on the justice of God and the need for being able to usher in righteousness through the systems of the world. And so even though that concern is a very valid concern, as Dr. Zheng was mentioning, it's a concern that has caused the evangelical church to really consider again, you know, we've been preaching the gospel, but we've been neglecting the needs of the poor. We've been neglecting some of the social structures that need to be reformed and touched by the gospel as well. But the emphasis upon the justice and the need for some of these structures to be transformed can sometimes lead us to just ministering in a way that we attend to the physical outward needs of people and neglect the spiritual needs, and neglecting that the spiritual, the inward transformation is key for being able to transform the outward structures as well. And so both need to be happening in a balanced way. Another theological overbalance that we see happens with what some call the prosperity gospel, where there's true emphasis on God's grace, God's blessing in people's lives, the need for faith, the need for us to anticipate in faith that God will heal, that God will indeed bless and provide as we are faithful in doing our part when it comes to material matters, whether it's the tithe, the offerings, or whatever. But it does not necessarily mean that this will always happen. If we neglect, on the other hand, that suffering and taking up the cross, and that our Lord did indeed suffer without friends, without material things. He said that if anyone would follow me, that there's no guarantee, that the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And so if you follow me, you need to count the cost. And so the overbalance there on the prosperity gospel, that's indeed true, that God will bless, that God does provide for material things, that God does provide for healing, is in need of having a balanced perspective. Well, these are two areas that perhaps being from a more conservative evangelical tradition, we would say, oh yeah, we understand that. That's something that other people have to struggle with. But there's also, I think, the concern that we have as evangelicals and that those who really do put a rightful emphasis on preaching the gospel. And I thought this came across very clearly in a question that was addressed once by a pastor, and he said, you know, we have so many people who come to Christ, who receive healing, they pray, they're baptized, they continue on in their old way of life, and then soon we no longer see them in the church. And he said, what do we do to keep them coming to the church? Or what do we do to get people to serve in the church? How do we get people to start to tithe? And the more I listened to this, I began to wonder, now, what was the message? What was the gospel that they really heard? What was the content of the theological education that we're providing to people? And is it really the whole gospel that is being proclaimed? Or is the gospel that we are proclaiming so heavily weighted on the matter of atonement, salvation from our sins, that we speak about the grace of God and we have rightfully emphasized that it's only by God's grace that we are forgiven of our sins, but once we receive this grace of God, once we receive Christ, we are forgiven, we are guaranteed, our salvation is in heaven. And so the thinking, I think, becomes, okay, the Christian faith is just about receiving God's grace. It's about then having sin forgiven and then being prepared for a future in heaven. But I don't think that our proclamation of the gospel gives enough of a whole picture as Jesus presented when he said, the kingdom of God has come. The kingdom of God has come in his coming. Repent. Turn from your way and come into the kingdom of God. Turn from your way, repent. Turning from our own way and coming under the lordship of the King who has come. And I don't think we oftentimes proclaim this part of the message as clearly. We speak too much of simply receiving in terms of like a gift, that we receive a Christmas gift, and so once you receive that gift, you've got it. And so people think, okay, what's next? But I think, like in Pasatai, we say ra, right? Dai ra. But I think this dai ra has to have this other dimension that, and again, I'm looking at Thai words, but you also use the word yom ra. And I think that yom ra part of the receiving is a very, very important emphasis that needs to come in a full presentation of our message. That people need to understand that receiving Christ is receiving the Lordship of Jesus Christ. That Jesus came to be King of their lives. And the way that we have life and life in its fullness is going to be found in being a part of His kingdom where He reigns over our lives. And until we really are helping people to understand that that's where life is, they think that, oh, life begins when we die. After I receive Christ, I've got it made already, and so I go on living my life, and everything else then is optional, whether it's serving at the church, discipleship programs, all these other things are just simply add-ons in the Christian life. They're not at the very core of the Christian life. And that's what people need to understand when it comes time for us to present the gospel message. We need to be presenting a message that gives a full picture of what this relationship with Christ looks like. I think I mentioned the name of Dr. Dallas Willard. His writings have been so very helpful for me to think in terms of this kingdom of God. Now again, kingdom of God can be a very scary term because sometimes people have overemphasized this matter of the realized kingdom of God. And so, that's also part of how some have approached the transformation of social systems as being part of what they anticipate the kingdom of God to come here. But as I've said in the paper, the kingdom of God is not simply now, here and now only, but there is indeed a future fulfillment of the kingdom of God that we still do anticipate. And again, we need to be presenting the full orbed picture of this kingdom of God. But what's very foundational in this is that it's the kingship, the reign of Jesus Christ over each individual's life that we want to give proper emphasis to. Another aspect that oftentimes when we look at Matthew 6:33 and we say, seek first the kingdom of God, we oftentimes forget the second part of that. We don't put enough attention on and His righteousness. That a very, very integral part of the kingdom of God is that God has revealed His righteousness in Jesus Christ, and His plan for us is to have our lives transformed. That righteousness is really for here and now living as well. It's not just simply a righteousness that we will have as we stand before the judgment seat of God, but that God wants to be transforming our lives today, here and now, in the kingdom of God through His Holy Spirit, that we might become more and more like Jesus Christ. So, seeking His kingdom and His righteousness is all part of the same package, and that people need to understand that salvation is so that we are being taken from the dominion of darkness and transferred into the kingdom of Jesus Christ and His righteousness. And this transfer is occurring as our lives are being transformed through the inner work of the Holy Spirit. So helping people to understand that this is all part of what we are receiving, not simply the Christmas gift idea, but receiving in submission as well through the reign of Jesus Christ as King over His life. Okay? So that's what the form of theological education is that I believe is really necessary in terms of content. It's a whole message that needs to be emphasized. Let me take a quick look at my notes to make sure that I've covered what I wanted to say on that. Okay, and then moving then to the matter of the means of theological education. I think when we approach theological education from a holistic viewpoint, we need to be willing to not be limited to our traditional forms. We have very traditional forms of theological instruction, and most of these theological forms look like lectures in classroom settings, whether it's in a seminary or whether it's in a Sunday school class or more creatively in small groups. But we have certain kinds of forms that we are used to. And I think when we think holistically about education, we need to look at the model of Jesus. And it's so interesting as we read in the Gospels where Jesus taught. You know, you can see Him teaching along the sea, you can see Him teaching from boats, you can see Him teaching from mountainsides. There's no place that is off limits or out of bounds for a lesson to be taught. And so often, these lessons can be taught in these different places because Jesus is spending time with people. He doesn't just have appointments with people, but people are with Him throughout. And this is, I think, a very important part of the means of theological education that we need to be looking very, very closely at. That besides the institutional, traditional forms that look like lectures and classrooms, we need to be able to complement that with more personalized approaches. And I think these personalized approaches are oftentimes one-on-one, and they can take advantage of different situations that occur. The matter of discipleship training and doing one-on-one discipling is something that I think we have heard about enough, that people have tried and programmed, and it's not far from being a new idea. But what has oftentimes been the limitation is that we have treated disciple making as being a program. And I can still remember my friend back in Chicago. He was an experienced discipler and teaching in a seminary. And when my friend Jerry was beginning that course, I said, you know, Jerry, I want to sit in your seminary classroom because I want to see how you teach discipleship in a seminary classroom. And so when I looked at Jerry's materials that he was going to use at the class, I said, you know, Jerry, this is just simply the design for discipleship booklets that I remember meeting together in small groups with. And I said, how do you teach discipleship this way? And Jerry said something that really helped me. You know, Jerry said, Leaf, the materials are just the excuse for getting together. And you know, that was a really important insight, that it's not the materials, it's not the programs, but it's the relationships that you spend time together in where discipleship occurs. And if we catch that idea that disciples are not produced by programs, but it's people who produce disciples. It's as we spend time one-on-one with people that we can impart things into people's lives. And as we know people personally, we understand what are their issues in life. We understand how they learn best. You know, so many of our people are not people who enjoy reading, and yet our academic institutions emphasize reading. And if you know, if we're going to be discipling people here in Thailand, and we know that the statistics are that a large percentage, a large majority of our people, especially the unreached people of our communities, don't read, then we're going to have to approach this a whole different way. We're going to have to start using more oral methods of storytelling. We're going to need to transform our methods so that we can educate people holistically. And until we get to know the people, until we're able to meet with them on a small group or a one-on-one basis, we're not going to have that kind of flexibility to transform our way of teaching, our way of imparting these things to people. So, what needs to happen? Well, we can wait for institutions to develop programs and to assign people to doing this. But that's not going to happen. That is not going to happen. You're not going to see, especially in seminaries, time being designated for faculty members or for students to go and disciple other people. The truth is that discipleship will need to start from the grassroots up. For people to catch the vision for being able to impart your life to others, it will take personal initiative. You will need to personally decide that you want to impart your life to help other people grow in Christ. You will need to take time. You will need to also commit yourself to being transparent with your life. Transparent with your life means that you also are in the process of being transformed. If you want to help people, as Dr. Jun mentioned today, if you want to help people to develop in character, you know, if you want to address hard things in people's lives, like honesty, like purity, like things that, you know, make other people squirm, we can't just start by pointing the finger at other people's areas of weakness. We need to be willing to share our struggles in these areas. We need to be able to say, God is in the process of transforming me. And so then we can be mentors, then we can be models for other people. Because as Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. As I'm being transformed by the Holy Spirit, then you also come along. See, that's the way that I think we can personally be involved in discipling other people. It's not programs that will produce disciples. It will be person. And so the kind of holistic theological education that I want to advocate with you today is not the kind of holistic theological education that's simply institutionalized, that's only for the academic levels, but I want to encourage you to make holistic theological education something that is practical and personal and that you can take outside of the classroom, that you can apply everywhere, because the needs are great. Okay. I think I'll conclude my remarks there and just open myself up for any questions that you have. Please feel free to challenge. I welcome that. It will stimulate my thinking as well. And if you want to use Thai, you can use Thai and I think a Thai sound will help me.
You can help yourself.
Yes, Frank?
I just met you today. And
that's okay, you can still ask hard questions.
But in regards to the science,
I can hear you, and I'll repeat your question, Brian.
How many years have you been here, and what have you learned about discipleship as a year? Or is it the same as the kind of discipleship you're doing in the
life? Thank you. Brian's question is, how has discipleship been different here in Thailand and in this context? As compared to the kind of discipleship that I was involved in ministering. My background, Brian, in the United States was that I was involved with the Navigators Ministry, and so I didn't have a formal theological background before, my early years as a Christian were really formative years that I was not in a theological classroom. I was not even in a church Sunday school classroom, but I was in a small group, and people were helping me one-on-one. I was in the Navy at that time, and later on, then I went to seminary and got involved in the church's ministry. And it was always a challenge to be able to try to move beyond a program approach to discipling in the church there. The church tried a discipleship program. I was involved in that discipleship group program. And the expectation of people in the church, because they were people who had been in the church for a while, it was much more difficult to work with people who had already been in the church. But when there were new Christians, people who were just growing in Christ, there was definitely a fire about them, and you could teach them much more readily. That's one of the things that you find. Here in the seminary environment, I came to BIT 15 years ago, and my assignment was really to teach in theology and in evangelism. And that was my expectation, that I was going to be teaching in the classroom. And very soon after, I realized that my language ability was not going to come along quick enough that I would be able to effectively teach. And so I looked and I said, well, there are enough people here who can teach already theology and they can teach evangelism. They don't need me to teach these subjects. But I said, okay, well, maybe I can help with teaching English for theological purposes. And, if it was just teaching English, that's not what gets me excited. But it was just like my friend Jerry said, it's just a way of being able to also develop relationships. And it's those relationships that, you form in the classroom that sometimes carry over outside of the classroom. And you'll find people who are interested, who want more time, and you can impart as much as people want to by spending time with them. And so that's what I found in terms of my experience is working outside of the formal classroom setting with individuals or small groups of people who wanted training. And so that's where discipleship can happen, and it takes place, again, on your own initiative. It is. You hit it right on the head, Brian. It's a matter of developing relationships. And so when I'm down now in Satun, you know, people oftentimes ask me, are you there to plant the church? And I said, no, I'm not there to plant any kind of organizations. And like what Dr. Jun was saying, you know, there's a lot of, there are all kinds of anxiety and restriction as far as religion is concerned. You know, you talk about conversion and you know, for Muslim people, they're afraid that you're going to try and do something like that. But I try to assure them that I'm not there to change anybody's religion. My response to that question about religion is that I don't care about their religion, because their religion is like their culture. I have Christian culture and traditions, but I'm not there for them to become like a Christian tradition. I wonder if this might be a helpful way to illustrate. Our screen there, if we had, if you can imagine a circle next to the screen, goes around the screen, and we call those circles around that screen different cultural groupings. So one cultural grouping might be the Karen culture grouping. One might be the Chinese culture grouping. We can talk about religious cultural grouping. Being from America, we come from a Christian culture grouping. Okay, so we'll make that a one circle and call it the Christian culture grouping. We can have a Muslim culture grouping, a Buddhist culture grouping. But if we said that the area in the middle, the white part in the middle, was really where Jesus Christ reigns as the King in the kingdom of God, our task is to help people who are in these different culture groupings to come into the kingdom of God. Now, not everyone from that cultural grouping is going to come into the kingdom of God. We're going to try and help as many to come into it. But they don't need to come out of their culture grouping to come into the kingdom of God. You see, that's the idea, is that we can have people staying in their culture and still being able to live as citizens of the kingdom of God with Jesus Christ reigning over them. And so, again, what we're trying to do in Satun is to help people to come into a relationship with Jesus and to grow as disciples of Christ. Not trying to set up churches. They can do that one day. We trust that the Lord will do that. But thank you for your question, Brian. Are there other questions? Everybody awake? Ready for some holistic exercise? Yes, John William, thank you.
Hi,
hi, Kam.
ขอบคุณนะครับที่แบ่งปันแล้วก็จริงๆผมชอบในความคิดของดร.เจอรี่ที่พูดถึงใช้ห้องเรียนหรือว่าใช้มัตติเรียลเป็นโอกาสได้สร้างความสัมพันธ์กับคนนะแต่ว่า holistic theological education มันคงเป็นไปไม่ได้นะถ้าจะให้ BAT จะไม่มี system เลย หรือว่าจริงๆแล้วอาจจะสิ่งนี้จะกลายเป็นช่วยอาจารย์ลีดจะมีความคิดยังไงที่จะช่วยให้พวกเราเนี่ย ในฐานะเป็นครูเป็นนักเรียนที่จะบาลานซ์ในสิ่งที่เรากำลังทำเพราะว่าในด้านหนึ่งของการเป็นครูสอนให้เขาคิดให้เขาทำด้วยตัวเองอีกด้านหนึ่งคือการสร้างความสัมพันธ์ที่เขาจะเรียนแบบแล้วก็ทำตามเราสองสิ่งนี้จะทำยังไงที่เราจะบาลานซ์และเขาสามารถที่จะจบจากเบียร์ดีด้วยเกรดที่ดีเป็นและมีคุณภาพทั้งการเรียนรู้ในความคิดกับการเปลี่ยนแลกเตอร
์ครับขอบคุณครับ I think again John Lydia as I mentioned it's hard for institutions to program for discipleship and this is why I believe that for most institutions, I think especially as I've seen here in Thailand, we haven't yet become convinced that this is how we want to really invest in training the next generation of leadership. That we don't assign teachers that responsibility. In other words, when we assign, we give time, we make that a focus, a priority. And so, unfortunately, from my experience, it had to come from my own initiative. It had to be my own. Sometimes if people ask me, who asked you to do this? I have to say, Jesus. Because that's the truth. Sometimes you just have to know that God is calling you to do something and it's the right thing to do. No matter if somebody else is giving you that responsibility or says good job or not, it's just the right thing to do. And sometimes when what you're doing proves to be fruitful, then institutions will oftentimes pick up on it. But that's why I believe that it has to grow from the grassroots up, that it unfortunately is not yet at the place, but as we have administrators as well in these kinds of meetings, hopefully, you know, those of you who are in administration and have those opportunities and can impact that as God would convince you that this is something that you want to invest in, that you make those decisions as to how people allocate their time and resources. And so I would appeal to you for this holistic approach. Thank you.
I want to thank Ajahn Lee, Reverend Lee Fuji for his time to share his thoughts on meaning, methods, and means of holistic theological education with us. อาจจะเป็นว่าระบบการกระจายเสียงหรือไมค์หรืออาจจะเป็นวิธีการในการแปลร่วมกันในเวลาเดียวกันนะครับอาจจะทำให้เราเข้าใจไม่ 100% นะครับแต่ว่าก็นี่ก็เป็น exercise อันหนึ่งเชิงวิชาการก็อยากจะให้เราช่วยโอกาสเวทีแบบนี้ในการเข้าใจเนื้อหาเดียวกันในหลายมุมมองครับมุมมองที่อาจารย์ชอนแบ่งปันเมื่อเช้านี้มุมมองที่อาจารย์ลิศแบ่งปันไปวันนี้นะครับอาจจะออกมาคนจากคนละมุมมองของอาจารย์ชอนอาจจะออกมาจากวิชาการมากๆของอาจารย์ลิศอาจจะออกมาจากวิชาการบวกกับการสร้างสาวกนะครับก็เป็นโอกาสที่เราจะได้รับฟังจากหลายมุมมองครับก็ we have taken this opportunity to show you our token of appreciation. So we would like to invite Dr. Surasa to come and present our token of appreciation to you.